So welcome to Tree Ratna Day 2024. So my name's Nyanadara and I'm standing on Roman Road in Bethnal Green. And maybe I'll just tell you before we start what we've been doing so far today. So we started our day in Monmouth Street, which is where the movement started in 1967. And we heard from Naga Bodhi and from Ma Mahi, who talked about the early days of Tree Ratna, in particular talking about some of the treasures from the foundations exhibition at Ergian House. So that was a really wonderful evocation of that time and those early days of our movement. So what we did in the second session of this today is we did what we called an international metta bhavana. So I just had to take that out of my ear because I could hear myself talking about 2 seconds after I was talking and it was messing with my cognitive faculties. So yeah, so we started with Monmouth Street, and then we had an international metta bhavana. And we're just asking our cameraman to move so he doesn't get run over by the white van that's behind us. So we're having the full London experience today on Roman Road. So we had an international metta bhavana, very beautifully led by Manjusia, which was part of the London Buddhist Centre Saturday morning class. And we heard from people all around the world who rejoiced in their friends. So what we're going to do now is we're going to see a little bit of what goes on around the London Buddhist Centre. So the London Buddhist Centre isn't just a Buddhist centre, it's a village. So there's people who live and work around the Buddhist Centre and businesses and communities. And in the session, we're going to be talking to some of them. So yeah, the theme of the day is origins of transformation. So the London Buddhist Centre is one centre in this whole big mandala that we call Tree Ratna. And around this smaller mandala within a mandala, a circle within a circle, there's all sorts of things going on, people transforming their lives, working and living together. So what I wanted to do with this session is just talk to those people and ask them why they do that, what's meaningful about that, and how they feel that that's transforming themselves and also transforming the environment around them, transforming the world. So first of all, we're going to be visiting Lama's pajamas. So if you'd like to follow me, we'll come in and we'll talk to Achela Devi. So we're coming into quite a busy shop. Achela Devi's over there in the corner. So as you can see, this is a clothing shop largely. And welcome, Achela Devi. If
Yeah,
you'd like to
Madara.
take that microphone.
Yeah. Hello. Good to
Hello.
see you.
Good to see you again.
Welcome to Lama's Pajamas.
Thank you very much. And you might want to hold that a bit closer to your mouth.
Close to my
Is
mouth, yeah.
that okay?
Okay.
Good. Yeah, so I was just telling people what we've been doing so far on Tree Ratna Day.
Yeah.
And now we're in Lama's pajamas. And maybe you'd like to tell us what your role is at Lama's pajamas. What's your part? What's your part that you play in the show?
Okay, I'm with another colleague. I'm co-manager of Lama's Pajamas. Lama's Pajamas was founded by Anandi about 13 years ago, I think. And but she left last year to set up the Mandala Cafe,
Which we're visiting later on.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah.
And she left here last year, and Nikki and I took over together, so we job share.
Fantastic. And can you tell us a little bit, I mean, how does the shop work? Because some people, I don't know, some people will know what a charity shop is, other people
Yeah.
won't. So how does that work?
Well, it's quite straightforward. People donate everything that they don't no longer want, and they come here and donate it to us. And then we sort things through, and everything that is suitable, we price and put out in the shop.
That's kind of a wonderful business model, isn't it? That you
Yeah.
don't have to buy any of your stock,
We don't have
it
to
just
buy
all magically
anything.
arrives.
Yeah.
Yeah, and
Yeah.
even like at the moment, it's quite busy. There's a few people
Yeah,
browsing.
for a Saturday it's reasonably
Oh,
quiet.
is it? Okay,
Yeah.
right. Wow.
But it's ebbs and flows.
Yeah, excellent. And what inspires you to work in this way? Because it's a what we call a team-based right livelihood. So what does that mean?
It means that we try to run a business according to Buddhist principles. So we do business in an ethical way. We are honest. We are truthful, and that relates to the sort of things we sell, how we treat people, how we are with each other, how we relate to ourselves. It's basically Buddhist practice in a business.
So you said there how we relate to each other. So it's we say team based, don't we? So what does that mean?
So we have a team of six people who work here in this shop and also in Jambala, the bookshop. So it's very much about working together, building friendship through working together and through practicing together as Buddhists. We start each day with a short ritual. We start each day with a little check-in to see how everyone is. So it's different in that way from a normal business. So friendship is very much a part of working together.
And I imagine that's sometimes wonderful and maybe sometimes challenging.
Can be challenging, yes. At the moment we have a very harmonious team, so that works well. But it can be challenging in the sense of, for instance, I don't find it so easy to work in a team. So for me, that is a practice every day.
And can you say a little bit more about how that's a practice or what's challenging about
Well, I'm very introverted,
that?
so my ideal way of working would be just somewhere in a corner on my own.
And not talking to people all around the world
That's right.
online. You're very good.
No, I mean I can do it, but that is a working ground for me sometimes.
And what was I get? Yeah, so what's the sort of, I'm sure you said you get all kinds of interesting objects in your shop. So what's the most unusual thing you've ever had?
Oh, I don't know. Sometimes we haven't got a clue what we've got, and we have to do a little. What do you think? And then we try and look it up on the internet.
To try and identify what the item
What it
actually is
is.
and what its function is.
I think one thing we had was my colleague opened it. It was a little box and contained like silicon breasts, and she was like, "Ooh." But just also every day, like say kitchen utensils, and then you think, "What on earth is that for?"
And I have to ask you, how did you come to find a price for the silicone breasts?
Actually, we decided not to sell them. No, sometimes you take a decision that's not suitable.
It's suitable for sale. That's wonderful. And also, I suppose, I mean, how do you come to have the things that you have? Like, how I mean, there's a shop full of stock. So who donates it? Is it just people from the Buddhist community?
It's people from the Buddhist community, but I would say more just people who live around here in this area. Our customers, they come and buy here and they bring stuff. I think it comes from a wide range of people. Sometimes we get very expensive items like designer labels. Sometimes we get just the more bottom of the range things. It varies very widely.
And what particularly inspires you to work here in terms of that more communal kind of aspect?
Oh, I love it. I love that people know each other. So customers come here in the shop and then they have a chat. Obviously, when you've worked here for a while, you get to know people. So we have a chat with them. I love the fact that when I'm out on the street, I bump into
People that you know from shop.
people that I know from the shop. So I feel part of the local community. And I think that works for customers and it works for the team as well.
Wonderful. Excellent. Well, thanks for talking to us today.
Really nice,
We've
thank you.
we're going to have a little tour, and just before we finish, I just want to wish you a happy birthday.
Oh, thank you.
A little
So
bird told me that it's your
lovely.
birthday
Yeah,
today.
it is.
I'll leave you to find out who that little bird was.
Yes,
Okay,
thank you.
well, thank you very much, and good luck with your. One last thing I might ask you is, it seems to me that this is something that people could do anywhere. Right, have a charity shop.
Yeah,
So
I suppose
what
so.
are the key elements someone would need if they wanted to start a charity shop around their local Buddhist centre?
Well, I guess you need to find a space, and I guess you need to also think where it is. So if there's lots of footfall, that would be helpful.
Location,
Lots of
location,
people,
location.
location, location, location. You need to have a suitable space. You need to have a clear idea what you want to do. You need to have lots of energy, stamina, some financial backing, I guess. Marketing.
That's
Yeah.
it. Yeah.
I would recommend it.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what the lady said. So if you want to start a Buddhist shop, and could people, if people were curious, could they talk to Lama's pajamas? Would you be willing to
Oh,
help?
yeah, definitely.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. Okay, cool. Well, we might go on our merry way and wish you well.
Very nice to see you. Thank you
Thank you
very
for having
much.
us in your wonderful shop.
Pleasure.
I might come in later on and see if I can get a pair of jeans or
Please
I
do.
don't know.
Please do. That would be
Okay.
great.
Ta-ta for
Nice to
now.
see you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So we're just going to take a little stroll down the road, away. And oh, look, it's my friend Akasa Josie. Fancy meeting you here. Here you go. So we're just
Gonna
going to
ask
take a
me some
little.
questions.
I'm going to ask you some questions. You can actually hold that. I've got my own microphone.
Oh, thank
Yeah,
you.
so you can take it. It's all your own. So Akasa Josie. Oh yeah. So you live around here, right?
I do. I live in one of the women's communities around the corner. There's three houses next to each other on the road leading up to the park, and there's about 24 women living there together.
Wow.
So I think, I mean, they were bought quite soon after the Buddhist Centre and dedicated as communities
So
by
they've
about 30
been here for 40
decades.
years,
Yeah,
yeah, almost
something like that.
30, 40 years.
Yeah.
Wow. And
Yeah.
what's it like, like what I've noticed is I've been staying just in the community we're about to visit. And there's a lot of people around it from the Buddhist community. And what's that like when you live in the locale?
Yeah, it's very lovely. Like, I moved here from Adistana, which is, some people might know, the retreat centre. Sangharakshita spent the last years of his life in Herefordshire. And it feels a bit like that. You get Buddhists from all around the world passing through and coming and visiting and staying in the communities.
Very different environment though, isn't it? Pakistan,
Yeah,
like
it's a very different environment.
it's a urban environment. We've got taxis going past and police cars. And we just had a couple of boy races on motorcycles.
Yeah, it is a different environment, but very alive Sangha, very positive.
What do you do? Because you work in Sri Lanka, right? So what is it that you do? Seem to do a lot of.
It's pretty windy.
Oh yeah, goodness me! I wonder if people can still hear us.
Let's cross over. Yeah, I do. I work in Tiruvanna. I work for the public preceptors, who they're responsible for ordinations around the world.
Okay.
There's about 42 of them.
And a few of them live around here.
Yeah, actually, I don't think any live in the community that you're able to visit, but there's three, Vajramandu, Nyanavatara, and do live up.
And I think you live with a few of them, don't you?
I live with Dhamma Dinner in my trade, yes.
Yeah, fantastic. All right.
I'm going to hand
Oh, thank you very much. Well, here we go. Here's a little bit of inner city carry on for you. So we're going to, oh, look. Hello. So we're now going to go into the London Buddhist Centre building. We're going to go upstairs. And this is Fred. Say hello, Fred.
Hello, everyone.
And Thomas.
Hi there. Welcome.
So let's go.
Let's do it. We might as well point out that we have a few paintings on the way up. So this is,
Oh.
I believe, this is my friend Andrew, who lives here at the top. And yeah.
And I think, was that a mural that was on the wall next to the courtyard?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah.
So you see, there's another one of these framed in the mural, which is due to be repainted.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
So the mural that's due to be repainted is was Maitreya Bandhu's, but I think it's covered, so it's still kind of there.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Okay,
So we
so onwards and
continue.
upwards, we'll go up the stairs. So this, of course, used to be a fire station.
Yeah, that's right.
You can keep that mic all to
Okay,
yourself because
cool.
I've got
Okay,
my
you've got
own
your
one.
own.
Oh, another piece of art.
So this is it's probably one of two Vidyadhaka paintings you'll see. So Vidyadhaka used to live in Sukhavati, and he used to work at the LBC, at London Buddhist Centre. And I think we're sort of custodians of a few of his paintings. So this one's been here for quite a while.
Mm.
And there's a little detail here that says, later you will understand how truly good these times have been. Oh. Which
does that ring true in terms of your...
It certainly does, but I'll only know later, I think.
So. I suppose because you haven't got much experience to look back on to compare it to, or...?
Yeah, well, myself, I've been here 2.5 years, so... Oh. But yeah, I mean, even so far...
Okay, fantastic. So we'll go inside and we can make some of your fellows.
Yeah, we will. Okay. Oh, better hide the code.
There's some lovely plants here. So there's a man upstairs called Paramabando who's got a green thumb. Well, he might even have more than one green thumb. And he looks like a plant. So here we go.
Right. Okay, so come through. You've just seen the back of James. James is one of our honourable, venerable young people.
Okay. Oh, look, it's a whole big gang. Fantastic. Ooh. So where do you want me to sit?
Well, wherever. I mean...
Maybe I'll sit over by Harold there.
Yeah. Okay.
Fantastic.
Yeah. So how many people have we got online? Do we know how many people
Actually, I don't know the answer to that question.
Okay. Well, welcome to everyone. This is Sukhavati. This is our lounge. This is not all of us, but this is... so we're 13 in number in the community, but this is those of us who are around at the moment. And I don't know.
What we could do is we could go around. If you want to talk, you need to talk into that microphone. I've got my own microphone. But maybe you could say your name and how long you've been living in this house.
Mm. Okay. I mean, I've already said, but my name's Fred, and I've lived here for 2.5 years. I moved in with a few others here. I moved in with Hiral, who's over there, and Thomas, and Dianato as well. So we're a little...
Oh, yeah. That's true, but I've actually been living in the building for 12 years. Wow. But I switched from a different community for good reasons. To come to this one because there's actually two communities within this block. So yeah, really thriving. It's lovely to live with other guys actually, and it's very thriving. That's what I like about it.
And why? Tell us why did you move downstairs? Because there's another community.
Yeah, upstairs. I was living with Maitribandhu, Yarnavacha, and Paramabandhu. Paramabandhu was my preceptor, and Yarnavacha and Maitribandhu are public preceptors. So it felt like they were. it was great to live with them for a bit and they were training me. And then this community needed a bit of help, a bit of support. So came down as sort of away from them, moved like away from their sort of,
a little bit like out of the greenhouse and planted out.
That's right, out of their dominance into here. And really lovely to sort of help this community thrive. It was already doing very well when I moved in, but it was lovely to sort of be part of it and watching it thrive and grow. And now... we've got James and David Mitra and everyone else who are going to introduce themselves as well. Yeah,
great. So James.
So I'm James and this is David Mitra. I've been here just over a year now. I moved in like January last year. Things have been good. I'm also not the newest person.
So you could tell us what inspired you to move in.
What inspired me to move in? Well, when I first started coming along to the center, I was traveling in about an hour and a half every time I was coming in here. So an hour and a half one way, an hour and a half on the way back, just because like I live so far away.
Mm.
And so part of me was just like I wanted to live near the center. And there was an opportunity that came up when some guys upstairs, actually in Samagavasa, those guys, three of them were going away to get ordained. So I stayed with them for 3 months whilst they were away, sort of stayed in room. I just really loved living in community, basically. Mm. And then moved back out of London. And then, anyway, there was an opportunity to move in here. And I've just loved sort of deepening in, because it's just as a place of practice, it's, there's much more to living here than just like a physical space that you're in. Mm. It's much more about like how we are with each other and encouraging practice and things like that, which I've really, really loved and benefited from.
Great. Fantastic. Thank you. And David Mitra.
Hello.
Hello.
So yes, I'm David Mitra. I've been living here for 9 years this time around. I did live here for a couple of years almost in 1980-81, but this has been my longest stint here in Sukhavati and at the London Buddhist Centre.
Mm.
So I've been ordained 50 years. So I've been around a lot a bit. I'm by far the oldest member of the community. I think the next youngest, and the next oldest after me is Dionata, and he's almost 40. So, still quite young. Yeah, I'm 37 years older than he is. I'm 76. It's a wonderful community. This is by far the most harmonious community I've ever lived in. It's also the youngest I've lived in since the very early days of Balmore Street.
Tell us about Balmore Street, because some people won't know what that means.
Balmore Street was, I lived at 5 Balmore Street. In fact, I was one of the 5 founding members of the first ever men's community in Sri Ratna. And it was an accident. I mean, Loka Mitra put on a notice on the board at the Archway Centre saying, if anyone wants to live together, any fellow meditators, just write your name here. And it just happened to be 5 men. So it happened that the first men's community was an accident, really, in that regard. So I was one of those. That was my first experience of community. And Loka Mitra, myself, and Dari Mitra were all ordained together from that community a long time ago. That was in 1974. January 74, we were all ordained together. Loka Mitra was thriving in India. Arya Mitra unfortunately died about 10, 15 years ago. I'm still alive.
And you said there were 5 of you?
Yes. I mean, the other two left the movement very shortly afterwards. One was actually effectively a Hindu. He had a Hindu teacher, and he... You know, he was a bit of a misfit, actually, but nonetheless, he's quite sincere. He used to teach yoga at the Archway Centre. The other person was Paddy Ball, who eventually got involved in the LA Zen Centre. He started off, he became very interested in Zen and felt he needed discipline. He was a sort of anarcho hippie, if you know what I mean. He definitely needed discipline. There's no question of that. But we try to encourage him to stay and say, look, this is a place to develop self-discipline. There should be no problems. But he wouldn't. He'd had enough and he left.
And just before we move on, I'm just very fascinated to ask you what it's like being the sort of senior member of the community with all these young.
It's absolutely wonderful. I mean, I can't imagine living anywhere where I'd be happier. And I think one elder in a community is quite enough, because, you know, otherwise, honestly, I mean, there's no implied criticism of anybody, but if you have too many heavyweights in a community with a few younger people, I think it can be difficult for them to be themselves. Whereas this lot keep me on my toes, but I keep them on their toes too. But I love it. I wouldn't choose to live anywhere else. It was not a young community when I moved in. It was more of a middle-aged community, frankly. But Vidyadhar and I were determined to get more and more young people in, so that as people left, as inevitably they do, we got the youngest candidate in. And slowly it got transformed into this wonderful community of young men. I absolutely love living here. I can't imagine being happier anywhere else, as I said before. So that's
fantastic. And who have we got next?
We got Bodhi Matty.
Bodhi Matty.
Yes, I'm Bodhi Matty. Well, I was just thinking of how good it is having David Mitchell living with us, actually. Because, we're all, definitely a different generation. So it's really good, you know, just hearing the stories from the early days and having your experience there with us. So I really appreciate that.
So this community does go back a long way, doesn't it? I mean, you mentioned David Mitchell lived here in the early 80s.
Well, I mean, this community was here as a community before London Buddhist Centre opened, because it was a totally wrecked building. You just can't imagine. I mean, there's no windows in for a start. Most of the floorboards had been ripped up. All the old Victorian fireplaces were torn out. And so it was a complete mess. But yet, I think there must have been at least 6, 7, or 8 people moved in, including Surita, I remember, and of course, Subhuti. And they just camped here. And gradually, that would have been from about 1976 or 75, late 75, I can't remember. But gradually, out of that terrible, wrecked space came this absolute jewel.
And how do you feel? Do you feel that history when you live in this place, Bodhi Matty?
Yeah, quite often when guests come, pretty much most people will say, oh, at some point I lived here, you know, especially older members. Most guys seem to have at some point come through.
Yeah.
So it's quite exciting being part of that kind of history.
Yeah. And you also work at the Buddha Centre, don't you?
Yes, I work at the Buddha Centre, which is, well, our office is literally just across the terrace.
So
it's about, well, James, Fred, Dinoth is a Mitra convener. Also, Steer Manus is not here as the centre manager.
And what's
about
it like?
The community work.
And what's it like, you know, living and working with the same people?
I really love it, actually. Yeah. It's really good because then there's continuity. Like, you wake up, you know, meditate together, have breakfast together, put on our shoes together, brush your teeth, walk across the terrace. It actually works quite well. And I think we're quite good at not talking about work too much, like around dinner and stuff like that.
Okay.
So it does actually feel like we've got like a kind of a friendship life and a work life, and they're separate things.
Yeah. Yeah, wonderful. And yeah, fantastic. So, and who have we got? Who have we got next?
So now we've got Nemo.
He's the youngest. Hello, I'm Nemo. I'm the youngest.
Oh, you're the youngest.
And the newest.
And the newest.
I've been here for 3 months, I think. Okay. 4 months. I don't know. Since January, and I'm sharing a room.
Oh, and have you? And how? What's that like? What's sharing a room like? Have you done that? Have you shared a room before in your life?
When I was a lot younger, I shared a room with my younger brother, but to be honest, I grew up in a house that was like very open plan. Like my walls were essentially just like sort of curtains, so I've sort of like always been sharing a room, actually. So quite used to it, but at the same time, it is like we do share a bunk bed, so it's quite different. And yeah, it's really lovely, actually. I think sharing rooms is just like a really good way to get to know someone. And you have to be very mindful of how much mess you're creating, and, you know, sort of, yeah, be very aware of the other person.
So is that something you try and consciously cultivate, awareness of other people when you're living?
Yeah, I definitely think. I don't know why people are laughing.
I don't know why people are laughing. Would someone like to say why they're laughing?
No, I mean, I think people are very aware to, like, well, most of the time, clean up after they've, you know, cooked or whatever. Mm. And we, you know, each take it in turn to cook for the community. There's one cook every night, and then we sort of wash up together, and there's community activities that happen. So on Thursday, we have like community night, and we like check in and talk about our feelings. And it's very wholesome.
Very good. So maybe, should we hear a little bit from...
Yes, Cyril.
Hi.
Hi, Cyril. So what maybe you could tell us a little bit about what community nights are like. What sort of things do you get up to?
Yep. So typically we'll be in this room and we'll sit around like we're doing right now. And essentially we'll just share our lives together. We'll kind of go around one by one. We'll talk about things that are going on for us in the week. Could be particular dharmic things that we're exploring, could just be things that are going on in our personal lives. Things that are positive, but also things that we might be struggling with as well. So really, we're just trying to open up to each other and share our lives with each other in quite an intimate way. So I really appreciate it. And we also do different things. So I had my birthday celebration a few days ago. And that's a really lovely evening. So when it's someone's birthday, we go around and we rejoice in them. So we say really positive things about the person. We give them lots of gifts, lots of cards. We bake a special cake. So
what cake did you bake for you the other day?
What was it? It was like a banana, raspberry, no sugar, high taste kind of. Yeah. It was a good cake, yeah.
You felt well celebrated.
I did. It's a very, as Nemo was saying, it's just a very wholesome way of living. I used to live alone for about 7 years, so it was quite a contrast then moving in here and living with 12 men. But in a way, I couldn't imagine living in a different situation. It's just very wholesome, very positive.
So just on that, so in a little while, you're going to be living in quite a different situation, aren't you? What's happening?
Yes, so I'm going to be getting ordained. I'm going to be heading off in about a week or so. So essentially, I'll be going to Spain. And in some ways, it will be fairly similar in the sense that there will be a community out there, which I'll be integrating into and living with. And in many ways, it feels really nice to have practiced, you know, living with people here to go off and embark on that journey and live with others in Spain as part of the ordination course.
Well, good luck. Fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Great. All right. And last but not least.
Hi, I'm Thomas.
So, Thomas, I have to ask you what you do for a living, because it's rather unusual.
I work in the civil service. I'm in the marine and fisheries department, and I do sustainable policy. But my job title is the crab and lobster policy lead for all of England. So I make sure that crabs and lobsters are taken care of and well managed. And I don't know, that we have, you know, the ecosystem that they're involved in is protected. So that's the sort of work that I do. But I spend a lot of time, you know, talking to fishermen and environmental organizations about crabs and lobsters and all sorts of other things involving that. So, yeah.
Yeah. You're the crab guy.
I'm the crab man.
You were introduced to me as the crab. By the way, yeah. I should say, I've been staying here the last couple of nights, and it's been a very, very enjoyable experience. It's a very positive kind of experience. I imagine it's not always plain sailing, though. Like, are there challenges in living with 13? Is that what you said? 13 men?
To be honest, interpersonally, not that many. I mean, you'd expect more. I think we are an extremely harmonious bunch, and there's a spirit of friendship that's very, very strong. So I'd say almost none, as far as, you know, how we relate to each other. The challenges are probably more internal. I think everyone here has had challenges, but it's like anything in the Dharma. Actually, if you try to commit to it, something, you get a bit of a backlash. I think the community is extremely inspiring. You've got really, you know, great practitioners, people training for ordination, people trying to change their lives, and that causes you to, you know, want, part of you wants to do the same, wants to follow, and another part of you, it resists, I think. And that's, I think, probably the main challenge that most people face, or at least that I face.
And how does that kind of manifest in your life, that challenge or that feeling of like wanting to and not wanting to?
Well, I think the things that you're attached to, like, come up. I think, well, for me, I think the things that I'm attached to, like, I don't know, I'm attached to, you know, maybe aspects of my career, I'm attached to my relationship, I'm attached to, like, sort of family life that I've got. And those sorts of things come up. In a sense, it's not a real existing tension. No one's forcing me to do anything. No one's forcing me to commit here. No one's forcing me to commit anywhere else. But you sort of feel like, oh, as you go deeper into the Dharma, as you want to go forth, parts of you have to be let go of in some ways. So that's
like a kind of a renunciation or a going forth or something like
that? I think so. And it doesn't need to be a specific change in your life that you have to make. It doesn't necessarily have to be an external one, actually. It sort of can be just an internal way of how you relate to other things in your life. But yeah, I found it challenging at times and extremely inspiring at times. And I have actually, well, I could say that I have actually decided to move out soon enough in the next few months, partly to resolve some of this internal tension as well, but not without any regrets of leaving the space and the fence. And that sort of thing.
Sure.
I'll be moving down like that there.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'll be here for, you know, breakfasts and brush. I'll brush my teeth here as well.
Maybe, so who? Maybe was Nemo? You were the newest member. Thank you.
Of course. Yeah.
Thank you. Can you tell me, like, what's it like living with? I suppose when you live with people, you get a sense of what a Dharma life looks like. And what's that been like for you? Like, because there's quite a few different people living broadly the same kind of life, but in different kind of ways. So what's that been like for you?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, people are living their life in different kind of ways. But I think what keeps it so harmonious is the fact that there's sort of a higher ideal. I can certainly say that, like, the fact that everyone's practicing the Dharma, and, you know, going to meditations in the morning and, you know, talking about the Dharma and opening up to each other so fully, it's kind of like the most positive conditions that you can, that you can really have. And it definitely, like, has changed my practice in a completely different way. Like, I feel like even, you know, even through rough times, it kind of, like, it kind of helps to have all this Dharma practice around you, even if your own practice isn't going that well. But
So I suppose I'm interested in this. A number of you have said this sort of opening up with each other and being, maybe Bodhimatta, you'd like to speak to that. Like, what does that mean? You know, that aspect of opening up to other people. Well, why does that make a difference? Or how does that make a difference?
How does that make a difference?
Yeah.
Well, I guess, you know, if we're having dinner together, it's very easy just to walk around quite a lot.
And
in a way, you could easily just spend all your time living with other people in that kind of way.
Mm.
So then I guess having a community network, kind of purposely trying to go a bit deeper and trying to like open up, you know, sometimes I feel like in when we're doing that, I can end up saying things I don't even quite realize I feel, but somehow, because there's a space to do that, you end up feeling like, oh yeah, somehow you can end up saying things you don't quite realize are there. And by virtue of doing that, you realize, well, I learn more about myself, and I feel like other people learn more about myself as well.
Yeah.
So it's good just having that kind of purposeful kind of context to do that, because otherwise, like, where else are you going to do that?
Right. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I've certainly noticed just a lovely ease, and you seem to enjoy each other in a very straightforward kind of way. To enjoy each other's company, which is, in a way, a very ordinary thing, but it's also very extraordinary and lovely to see. You know, I don't know, last night, what was there, 10 of us sitting around the table or something like that.
Mm.
And you know, one of the things that struck me is people made conversation.
It
seems oddly old-fashioned, but really delightful. People were having conversations. Sometimes there was one conversation happening on the table, sometimes there was two, sometimes there was three.
Mm.
But it was just very nice just to hear.
I think dinners are a real event. It's like every day it's like having Christmas feast or something.
And you have dessert. You have dessert every night. Is that
we do it every single night? Yeah.
is that a key condition for
harmonious
happy community living?
David Mitch is not so excited about desserts, but it's become a key feature. It's people think something's missing if they don't make dessert these days. Keeps people happy.
Very good. Well, look, on that note, we'll say goodbye to you. Thank you so much for welcoming us into your house, into your home, and your community. And what we're going to do now is pop over and visit another community. So thanks again. It's been a delight to talk to you all. And I'll see you back here later on, I suppose, or maybe for breakfast. Yeah.
All right. See you later.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye.
Great. Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah. Okay, so we're just going to cut down the hall again. Oh, no, we're going to go out that door, actually. So we're going to show you a little bit of the rabbit warren that is the London Buddhist Centre. They're out this little door. I think this is probably your commute, is it, to work?
Yeah, this is my commute.
Yeah.
About 10 seconds?
10 seconds commute.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a bit less time than James's trip to the Buddhist Centre.
Yeah.
An hour and a half.
Indeed.
Great. All right.
But you've revealed where we hid our carpets.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, we gave it a good tidy before you all came in.
Thank you very much. Okay. All right,
good. Enjoy.
Onwards and upwards. See you later. So, yes, we're walking. Oh, look, there's somebody on the ceiling. Look at that. I don't know if you can catch him. That's one of the fellow community members. There's Suryanaga on the Buddhist Centre roof, even. And on we go. So we're going just past the Sukhavati Library. And this is where the team work, who run the Buddhist Centre. We're going to go down the steps. Incidentally, this is where Sangharakshita lived when he used to stay in London. And there. Go on. What's your name?
Danu.
Yeah,
I used to have a party, but just been doing the 1 p.m. class.
Oh, fantastic.
It's just going out to the live stream.
Yeah, we're basically talking to people all around the world.
Wow, I saw you this morning near Mark.
Oh, thank you very much.
Hi.
Yes. And
hi, Mum.
I'm not going to volunteer you to talk online. Don't worry. If you want to. Not really. Okay. Love to talk to you, Danny. Talk to you soon. So this is what happens when you're in the centre. Is you just have these random encounters with people. It's rather lovely, actually. Here's another random encounter that potentially we could have. What's called Jumbala. So it's another of the businesses that we have around the London Buddhist Centre. And we're going to meet someone called Heather.
So this is Globe Road, which heads off in that direction. So there's more communities that live around there. So here we are. This is Jumbala Books, which is a long-standing business. So we'll go inside and we'll talk to Heather to hear more about it. Oh, look. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. You need one of those.
How do I? Oh, look, it's got ribbons. It's got
three right the day ribbons. So we were going to stand over there, weren't we? So this is a lollipop.
I was going to go there, wasn't I? And you were going to go over there. Do you want to?
Hello. Yeah.
She's there if we get really busy. And
oh, fantastic.
But no, but you can, yeah, and then you'll slip off.
Okay, so we're here in Jumbala, which is another of the businesses. You need to hold it like licking a lollipop.
Really, right in front of my face.
Well, no, not quite. Something. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about. Well, first of all, maybe you can introduce yourself. So.
Yeah, I'm Heather.
Mm-hmm. I'm Jasmine. I'm Jasmine.
There we go. Hi, Jasmine. And maybe Heather, you could tell us a little bit about.
Jumbala Bookshop. Yeah, so we're a charity for the Buddhist Centre.
Mm.
And we're kind of the sister shop to Lama's Pyjamas around the corner. Mm. And Jasmine and I both work 3 days a week in here and 2 days a week over in the other shop. So we are kind of a joint team now, which is great. So it's we're kind of, so there's six of us all together. And so I suppose our primary aim here at Jumbala, because we're a charity for the centre, is to raise money for the centre.
Mm.
But we're kind of just like one step outside of the centre, which is something I really enjoy, because we're kind of reaching out to people beyond the centre.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So you interact with people, all kinds of people, I imagine.
Yeah. I mean, so people come in here are Buddhist, but then we've got the local community as well.
Yeah.
And we're supported by them, by the donations that they bring into us.
Are the donations of books?
Yeah, all of our books.
Presumably you totally rely on.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, people come to me, are you accepting books? And I go, yeah. Bring them in.
And have you got a particular, Jasmine, do you have a particular love of books?
I love books. I'm not particularly well read. Quite often people come in and they say, oh, is this any good? And I don't have much to say. but I love books. I love to be around them, actually. I love to talk to people about it's nice. It's nice people get really passionate and they've all got their own interests.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm sort of a similar space to Jasmine. Mm. I mean, my training is visual arts, so I love the sort of area at the back of the shop, which is the visual arts books.
Yeah, it's a wonderful daily book I can see from here. Yeah.
But I mean, I think it's not just about being well read, and we've got a big team of volunteers as well. And one of our volunteers used to work in publishing, and another one's a translator of foreign language books.
And your publishing friend, what do they do in the shop?
Well, they come in every Thursday and they completely redo our window every week. And she's got a really good flair for doing it. She's knowledgeable about the books, but she also knows how to display them really well. I mean, that's something I enjoy as well, the display of the books, because...
it's your visual training.
Yeah, it's my background. I've done lots of trade fairs where you have to kind of display stuff.
Yeah.
But there's so much else that goes on, you know, it's sort of like organising the shop, kind of supporting the volunteers, supporting us.
Mm. And is that what inspires you to work here, Jasmine? Like the context of the work? What makes you want to work here and not somewhere else?
I think, well, for me, mostly it's the team. Mm. I think so there's this thing which is that the work that we do, I know that it supports the centre, and so I just feel, because I believe in that, in what the centre is doing, I feel completely free to give my time to that. And then in my kind of day-to-day, just the team, like I find the team so supportive in my Buddhist practice, and it's such a nice, like such a lovely harmonious team environment.
Yeah, fantastic. I keep hearing this word harmony. Maybe I could ask you, I mean, what's challenging about working in a team-based business selling books? Where do you find the challenges, maybe, Heather?
Challenges.
Just remember the mic now.
The challenges of
having changed me and asking you difficult questions.
I suppose I don't find many challenges working in the shop with books. I mean, there are challenges sometimes within the team because as there is in any community.
Sure.
But I think that's part of our practice. You know, it's a bit like the communities that I think you might have visited. You know, it really brings you up against yourself when there are disagreements in the team. Oh, I've got to sort this out.
Do you mean like, I want to do it like this and she wants to do it like that? Or he wants, yeah. So is that sort of thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it can be. Yeah. And you have to, you know, you have to kind of not just run away from a disagreement. You've got to stay in there with it.
Yeah.
And we're a really close team. We're sort of like a mini team we're a team as part of the LBC team, but we're a team in ourselves as well.
Jasmine, there does seem to be quite a bit of collaboration between different bits of the London Buddhist Centre team. Would that be a fair observation?
Yeah, I think so, definitely. Mm. I feel I only started working here about 6 months ago. I feel much, much more immersed in the whole LBC, I guess, Mandala.
Yeah.
So like, since working here, I feel like I've gotten to know the whole kind of team.
And, yeah, right.
Yeah, lots of the people who teach at the LBC as well.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, well, you mean get to know them rather than just seeing them on stage, as it were, on a Wednesday.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Jasmine's made like amazing. She's done amazing stuff since she's been here just for 6 months. I mean, it was her first full-time job since she left university.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
She's joined the teaching team of the sub 25 group and led a weekend retreat of the Grasner.
Oh, wow!
So she's really got involved with
them. Yeah, I think we encountered each other on a
Changemakers
weekend, wasn't it? I mean, I wasn't there. You know, as a young person, I was there as an old young person, formerly young person.
Young person with experience.
That's right. Thank you. That's very nice of you to say. Well, it's been lovely chatting to you, just getting a little bit of a sense. And something that I've heard is that it's your last day. Yeah. Are you moving on somewhere else? Or what's happening?
Sort of, yeah. Yeah, it's my last day at work. And before I head up to Akashavana next Friday
Fantastic. So we just heard from. Well, we were in Ariane's community.
You'll
be there.
There's quite a, they're calling it a bumper crop this year.
Okay.
Women being ordained. There's six people who are just, six women who are connected to the London Buddhist Centre and two other women, one from North London, who works at North London, and one in Brixton.
Wow,
there's eight of us together.
Good London crew.
Good London crew. I think there's only 19 on the whole retreat. Eight of us are from
London. That's a big contingent.
It is.
Well, I wish you well with it.
Yeah,
we're going to head
next door
now to the Mandala Cafe.
Yeah.
Great. And I'll just take that off you again.
Happy Tree Rotten Day.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Happy Tree Rotten Day. So, right. So we're just going to go next door from the bookshop. And we're going to walk back along the Globe Road. And the cafe's actually quite quiet. So, here we go. You just like hanging out here. Okay, so Jane just likes hanging out here. There's somebody ordering their food. There's some food to be ordered. And I'm hoping that we're going to have a little chat with some fellas. Maybe Satchamanas is going to come and talk to us. Maybe Ben is going to come and talk to us. Maybe Shraddha Mali is going to talk to us. There she is. Oh, there he is in situ. What are you doing in there, Satchamanas?
A bit of washing up.
A bit of washing up?
Yeah, we just had a little 2 o'clock rush after the meditation class.
Oh, yeah, so it's pretty quiet in here now.
Yeah, it's unusually quiet for a Saturday. There's a tube strike on.
Oh, yes, there's a tube strike on in London, which is actually a wee bit inconvenient. But do you want to come out and talk to us? You can cheer yourself up. Fantastic. So this is a few members of the Mandala Cafe team. We need another chair. So just say when you're talking, you need to talk into the microphone. I've got one my own, but you need to talk into that. So if you want to hold on to that, that's the best. That's
I feel like
best side.
Top star.
Yeah, you are for a moment. So what's your name?
My name is Shraddha Marlini.
Okay, and how did you come to be involved in this?
Well, first of all, I was involved because I am an architect.
Oh.
And me and my partner designed the cafe. We designed the cafe.
Right.
So for about a period of time before I got ordained, September 22, we were looking at what we could do. And then when I came back from ordination, the LBC Council were ready to move forward. So we had a working group, such as and a few other people, to choose the finishes. And
so you're very lucky to have an architect. In
probably
your
the only cafe in London where the person who designed it, the architect, actually works.
So it's very unusual for an architect to then come and work in the space that they design. No, I'm too busy in the cafe at the moment, but I'm very pleased to be doing that. Okay.
Maybe Satya Manas, do you want to tell us a little bit about how you got involved?
Sure. Well, about 2.5 years ago now, Abhay and Andy, who I co-founded this place with, approached me and said, do you want to run a cafe? And I said, absolutely not.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I knew what was involved. I knew the sort of times we're living in, how difficult it is to make a cafe work financially, how hard people work, etc. And she didn't stop. She asked 3 times, as is traditional.
Oh, right. And then the third time you were able to say no.
Well, I just had a few friends encourage me along the way, and I was looking for something else.
And what were you doing before that?
So I've been working for the LBC for about 8 years. I was managing breathing space before that, which is the LBC's kind of secular mindfulness project. Right. And looking for a change.
Yeah.
So just came next door, really, put an apron on.
And how long ago was that?
So we opened the cafe in September, and I've been working on it since about last March or April.
And
so just over a year now.
Yeah, and how's it been going? Because like you say, it's quite an old thing to do to open a cafe, isn't it?
Yeah,
in a town that has a lot of cafes.
Just around here, within about 100 meters, there's 5 other vegan cafes.
Really?
Yeah.
So you're a vegan cafe?
We're a vegan cafe, yeah. I mean, in some ways we were prepared for the unexpected. None of us, except for Simon, who was a professional chef, had any experience at all. Mm. So it was very much trial by fire. The first 3 months were crazy.
Yeah.
Very busy, very physically draining and exhausting, and learning a lot very quickly, making mistakes. And we're in a new phase now. We've done our forming and storming, I think, and things have settled.
Okay. Can maybe Shraddha Marlini, what does he mean when he says forming and storming? What's that about?
Well, I wasn't here the first 3 months, but, you know, you had a team of 5 people plus volunteers, and we sort of accrued some part-timers along the way as well, who, as Satya Manas said, one of them was a trained chef.
Ooh.
So he was training everyone.
A bacon aubergine.
Well, not just that, but then how many aubergines to order, and you know, how many, and then, you know, cooking ahead and planning new menus. And in a kitchen, it's a bit like writing strict form poetry or something, because you've got very specific setup. So
it's a bit like
the dish has got to fit the setup. You know,
oh, I see. So, this dish has got to fit in with the other dishes.
Yeah, so some dishes work really well here.
You need to have a line of 5 syllables, a line of 7 syllables,
exactly.
And another line of 5.
Yeah, it's a bit like haiku.
Yeah, right.
Food haiku. Yeah.
It's banneries and grills rather than a haiku setup.
It's a what and a grill?
A banneri and a grill, basically.
A banneri and a grill.
What can you fit in a banneri and a grill and an oven, basically?
Okay. So you've got to work within the equipment that you've got, as well as a complimentary menu that's not all just potatoes and all just
that's right, totally. So the all that was going on, you know, they were getting to know each other, moving into the cafe, which takes a lot of time, all the cups and saucers and cutlery and painting the courtyard and planting the courtyard and all that stuff, plus learning how to cook and learning how to run a business. So by the time I came in December, it was it felt like somewhere already going.
Yeah.
And we all watched a TV show called The Bear as part of our training.
Yeah.
Well, she was very helpful.
It prepares you for the worst.
Oh, right. Okay.
Yeah, it's terrifying. And people get locked in a fridge, things set fire, people shout at each other.
And tell me about that, because, you know, like, I mean, like the, you know, the caricature of a kitchen is you've got somebody who's extremely autocratic.
Oh, yeah.
Ferocious, terrifying everybody into submission.
Yeah.
And
in a very Buddhist-y way.
Can you do that in a Buddhist-y way? I mean, in all seriousness? Because, well, I mean, you've got certain ethical precepts that I'm assuming you follow.
We try our best, yeah. Well, that is a big question for us. Can you run a kitchen in a whilst following the precepts? I mean, you begin to understand why there's so much swearing in kitchens when you start working in them, because stuff goes wrong all the time. People order things off the menu, things set fire, the things burn, there's washing up machines that break up every 2 minutes.
And you've got pressure coming from customers.
It's pressure to front of house. I mean, our customers are lovely, so that helps us a lot.
Yeah.
But it's been a working ground, really. It's practice. Yeah. It's how to stay in positive mental states. That's the foundation of this place,
In the Zen tradition, they have this thing about the head chef. It's a very sort of prized role in a monastery.
Yeah.
And I never understood why they always said that you need a really experienced meditator, like the most experienced meditator in that role. Until I started working here, and then that's, you realize why.
And
because,
why is it?
Because you need to guard your mental states. You know, there's going to be a lot going on. All the stuff in the cafe, but between each other as well. And there's no time.
Right.
There's often not any time for an argument or a resentment really to fall. So, you're working quite.
So you've just got to let go of stuff, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to have a big old, you know, what do you call it? A restorative circle in the middle of a busy session.
Absolutely. We start each day with a dedication ceremony
By
the Buddha we've got in the cafe. So we chant that in unison, and we end every day with the transference of merit.
Fantastic. I don't know, this morning we did the dedication ceremony in Monmouth Street, where this movement started, and Bante wrote that dedication ceremony for that particular occasion. And
it's lovely.
It's quite a expressive set of words.
I get goosebumps every time we do it in the morning.
Every single time.
But it feels, I mean, it's funny, we called this place Mandala, and we didn't clock that around this Mandala.
So what is repeated every three. What do you say in that?
Well, we just follow the dedication ceremony, really. But
it's good. The lotus. So what does that mean for you and your work, the lotus petals of purity? When you're kind of like, I don't know, making a vegan sausage roll or something?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, I think in a way we've got the perfect interface between our practice and working. For me, I think the lotus petals are the connections that we have between people. You know, people seem to have, in the 7 months I've worked here, really flourished. And you know, I think because of the intensity of the work and how much we have to communicate all the time, and how much creativity goes into something like this, it's speed growth. It happens very, very quickly.
Around this mandala, this sacred spot, may the vajra wall of determination. So what about that one?
I mean, I think maybe that has to do with partly what we were saying before. You need a sort of strength of practice, actually, and that you help each other with that. We had a ritual at Christmas. Satchmanas gave us all a little vajra. So it's not a physical wall, but we've all got a bit of that vajra.
Yeah.
So it's something about being in touch with why you're doing it and what the truth is.
Yeah.
Because sometimes it can feel like just another job in a cafe. And, you know, cleaning toilets and that stuff as well.
Yeah.
But when you're in touch with the vajra, you know, that helps.
Yeah.
Remember why you're doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah. We have to do that every day.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. I suppose you do. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because, and then.
Yeah.
Well, the flames that transmute samsara into nirvana.
Yeah. What about them?
Yeah. It's in the kitchen, I guess.
That transmutes a raw aubergine into a cooked aubergine, right? And one of the things about this endeavor is it's a new endeavor, isn't it? You've started something new. I mean, there's been a cafe here before, but this is a new operation.
Yeah.
So can you tell us something a little bit about what it's like? Developing a new project.
Yeah. Well, for me personally, I find it extremely rewarding to have seen something from an idea, its inception, its conception, to it manifesting as a reality, and then a bit like having a baby taking on a complete life of its own, and becoming a, this sort of whirlpool of people, and to, you know, there's been hundreds of people involved in this project one way or another. And that's extremely satisfying and energizing and rewarding, as I said.
And energizing. So, yeah. I mean, you know, the flames that transmute samsara and nirvana and the sense of energy there.
Oh, yeah.
About having something, because it's new, right? There's something, what, there's something about that.
Yeah, there's a freshness. Budget. I think there's something really needed in the way that galvanizes energy when you get people involved in a project that they really believe in, that they really want to see happen, that they want to put a lot of energy into, and it just... it has a sort of magnetic pull for it. It just seems to get more and more momentum and people involved. And I think it helps foster those connections and build community in that way.
But also, Strata Malini, I mean, I think you don't really know how it's going to work or if it's going to work, do you? If you do something that's genuinely new, I imagine it's maybe a bit like, you know, divine.
Yeah, but I think that we did have the benefit of that there'd been a team-based right livelihood cafe here in the past, and that a lot of those people are still around. So, Badramati comes and does some has come and done some study sessions with us and our volunteers. So it's Neil Barcher, and we've got an ongoing program of that.
Yeah.
So you've got. It's very inspiring when Spadramati talks about what it was like working here.
Yeah.
I mean, they lived and worked together.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That team. So it's very inspiring when you hear about that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So you've got a sense of, you know, people who've walked the walk and know how to do it.
Yes.
I suppose.
I'm following in a lineage in this cafe, and it does feel like there's... it's a bit infused in the walls. I mean, that Rupa that we're sitting next to, that's been there for about 45 years.
Oh, right.
It's sat there through all the different incarnations of this cafe, including when we leased it out to an external company. It's still been there. In the foundations of the building, we've got a couple of double Vajras and a Tara Rupa just almost sat underneath us right now. In the kitchen, when we ripped up the floor, there was Vajras underneath there and lines from the Pali Canon.
In the kitchen,
yeah. We've floored over it now. But,
the Dharma is literally in the walls.
It's in the walls and the foundations and all around, really. And I think we picked up on some of the momentum that it had previously.
Yeah.
It's really nice, you know, the old veterans of the Cherry coming back here and seeing how we transformed the place and feeling very connected to it still.
So I suppose it's old and it's also new.
Yeah.
For me, it's coming when it was the Wild Cherry. I used to come here when my children were babies, and that was when I first bought the Dharma.
Right, so you're
local. Coming here, I'm a local, I've been here for about 25 years.
Okay. And I was hoping we could have a chat to Ben. He looks super busy right
now.
Should
I get him?
We're
with Ben. So we're just going to chat to somebody else who's even more of a local. Maybe just in the while he's being extracted from the till, what's next for the Mandala Cafe? Hey, Ben.
Hey, Ben.
can we answer that? Telling us what's next for the Mandala Cafe, and then I'm going to ask the question.
So, we've got to the point, I mean, you can attest to this, Ben, where we feel fairly confident in our offering of food and hot drinks and pastries and baking, etc. And I think we can start turning our minds to what else we can do with the space. So we had an art event last Friday. We're actually the guy who does washing up, who happens to have a postdoctorate in fine art, produced some pieces and talked about them. We're due to have a music event fairly soon. There's a lot of scope for us, lots of creativity and inspiration in the Sangha, people willing to offer their skills and talents, and so become a bit more of a creative hub. And you know, expression of the arts is Bante place so centrally.
So it's another kind of way that we've been hearing from different places how the London Buddhist Centre kind of spreads into the local community.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, it's been lovely for us getting to know our neighbours.
So I think, Ben, you were kind of literally a neighbour, right? Is that correct?
Yes, I am. I grew up in the block of flats that overlook this cafe.
Right. And how did you know about what was going on here when you were a kid?
Yeah, I did. Yeah. I had a loose awareness because it was quite promoted. I didn't know that Evolution, so there used to be a shop called Evolution.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
that was owned by Windhall. So I've got a house. Me and my mom have a house filled with Buddha statues and mosaic mirrors.
I know them well. I used to work for Windhall Sea Evolution.
And I didn't. I wasn't aware of the connection at the time, but I did grow up on the street right behind the centre. Yeah.
And then, how did you come to be like part of this cafe then?
Just the right timing, I guess. I feel really lucky. Yeah. I was in a job that I was really unhappy with, job that I thought was a dream job. I was
You were living the dream and it wasn't quite what you were hoping
It
for.
Wasn't a dream.
Right.
And I didn't know what was next. Yeah. And then this job was advertised on the website. And I think I applied at the last minute.
Yeah.
Like,
<you're>
like the midnight of the deadline.
Oh, right. Okay, right.
Decided to go for
squeaked
it.
In,
And it was the best thing I could have done.
Fantastic. And you've been here from the beginning. You're part of the kind of core team, I think you call it.
Part of the core team. So I started here in July when this was not the cafe that it is.
No, sure. And what are your kind of, and we'll probably have to finish up in a minute. By the way, we were going to talk to Ben from the beginning, but he was exceedingly busy. It's great big, you can see them behind us actually. A great gang of people just turned up. So that's why he's just popped in now. But what are your kind of hopes for, you know, what's next for Mandala Cafe? And in a way, in your own engagement with it?
I think I just want to continue to build on what we've built on far. Particularly growing up on the street, it just feels like this place has come alive and really welcomed in the Sangha and the local community. And it just feels like a warm hug of friendship when we come in. And I just want to keep building on that. And it's just wonderful, the reception I've had working here, the stuff we get from customers, but also just being part of a team that really cares about the cafe. I think all of the core team members here really, really are committed. And part of working in this cafe was the process of me asking for donation, because I just really saw what Sacha Reynolds and Abhay and Andy really have got from it. And being around them and just the depth of practice, it's just been really wonderful to witness and be part of.
Wonderful. Well, thanks very much. And great to chat to both of you. Great to chat to Father Mario. Hello to everybody online. we'll probably leave our little tour there. Well, just wish you well with the cafe. It's early days, but it looks like it's humming from what I can see. And I had a really delicious, I said a very delicious coffee. And a very delicious sausage roll. That's what I had for lunch. I'm just trying to remember.
About the most unhealthy thing we offer.
Is it? It was extremely delicious. Maybe there's a connection there. Anyway, thanks so much for chatting to us, guys.
Yeah.
And so we're going to leave our little tour of the London Buddhist Centre, Mandala Transformation now. And join us in an hour when we're going to be hearing a talk from Nagaketu. There'll be an opportunity to talk to friends and breakout rooms, and maybe see you then. We're going to have to buzz off now because we've got to get across to the other side of London. And see you later. Nice to be with you these hour and a half. Just say it to me. I invite you can all unmute now and say hello to each other. And and that will close the room. So we'll see you soon. All the best. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye.
Adios. Gracias. Gracias.